Hello friends, welcome to this video tutorial on ANSYS training. In the previous few lectures, we have taken a look at introduction to meshing. We have seen why meshing is important, the types of meshes, and then we have discussed about the mesh density. We have discussed how fine, medium and coarse meshes affect the accuracy of the results, and we have also seen about mesh optimization. So now let us take a look into an example of 2D meshing, where we'll be taking a look at all the tools in ANSYS which helps us to create a 2D mesh. So let's get started. So now I'm going to start by creating a surface, a rectangular surface in the design modeler. So I'm going to double click on geometry or drag and drop geometry onto the project schematic. I'm going to double click on geometry to get into the design modeler. It says starting design modeler. I hope you are pretty familiar with the sketching tools now. So my design modeler is now ready and my units is in meters. So let me just convert it to millimeters here. On my XY plane, now I'm going to have a new sketch and I'm going to sketch a rectangle like this. Something like this. A square basically. So it has to start from the origin and I'll draw something like this, and in dimensions I'll say 100 by 100. Okay, since the zooming levels are too much, so I'll say zoom to fit so that it fits into the screen. Now I'm going to create a, I'll say generate, and now I'm going to create a surface out of this sketch. I'll go to concept. Say surface from sketches. Now it is asking me for the base sketch. So sketch one is my base sketch. Say apply, and I'm going to say generate. Well, this is going to be the surface on which I'm going to create a 2D mesh. Once my work with the design modeler is done, I'll come back to my project schematic, and now you can search for the mesh under the component systems option. So I'll drag and drop mesh. It is asking me for which geometry. So close to the geometry there's a question mark, and now ANSYS is asking me as to which geometry you want to mesh. What I'm going to do is the geometry that we want to mesh is in this place here. So I just need to drag and drop this A2 into B2, right? So I'll just drag and drop this. You can see now there's a tick mark close to geometry, which means that ANSYS has read that this geometry needs to be meshed. Okay, so you can double click mesh. And now you can see here starting meshing. So the meshing window is actually going to open. This is going to take a couple of seconds. So my meshing window is open and you can see something called attach status is running. And when it says attach complete, the CAD model that we have imported or created using the design modeler and linked it with mesh is being imported. So this is what is the geometry. Now we are into the meshing window. If you can see here, it says B:mesh. Earlier here it is A:geometry, correct? So this is the design modeler and this is the meshing window. When it says ISOM, if you can see here, it says ANSYS ISOM CFD. So ISOM CFD is kind of another software which ANSYS actually uses the meshing algorithms of ISOM CFD. So this is a kind of a mesh algorithm which ANSYS has actually hired from ISOM CFD. Okay. A basic feature of ANSYS is that whenever you import a geometry, whether it is 2D, 3D, simple or complex, any geometry that you can import, and if you can just hit the generate mesh here, a basic mesh gets created on your body, right? So let us just try that. So when you say generate mesh and then click, since the mesh is not visible here, just left click on the mesh here. See, a basic mesh has been created. You may not be really happy with the refinement levels, but we will be exploring the options to make it finer later on. But you have to appreciate the fact that ANSYS can create a very coarse, basic, general mesh on any surface that you import. Any surface, any solid, any assembly of any complexity that you import, and you hit generate mesh, a coarse, a rough mesh would be created on top of it. So now if we can go in the details of mesh option, the first thing that is available here is the physics preference. So This option of physics preference is generally used to say what kind of analysis that you are going to do. For example, if you are going to do a static, structural, thermal or modal analysis, you can select mechanical. Or if you are going to do an explicit dynamics analysis, you can see explicit. Or if you are going to do a CFD analysis, you can say CFD. But in general, when you change the physics preference, the mesh density actually changes. So where can we see the number of elements? So in the previous introduction videos, we were discussing about the number of elements. Here it can be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, cross 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So I believe the number of elements has to be 64. So if you go to statistics, yeah, you can see here the number of elements is 64. Let's see what happens if I change the physics to CFD and say generate mesh again. So when you change any settings here, the old mesh becomes obsolete. Okay, so hit generate again and you can see that the mesh has become a little finer. The number of elements has increased from 64 to 196. Okay, so this is what happens when you change the physics preference. So let us continue by keeping it with Fluent. If you can come to the sizing option here, there's something called as the advanced size function. So advanced size function has four basic algorithms called curvature, proximity and curvature, proximity and fixed. So what this curvature actually means is the any sharp edges or any vertices where two edges meet is called as a proximity. So this square plate has actually got four proximities, 1, 2, 3, and 4. In the cases where you have any curved geometries, then what happens is you will be having something like curvature. In the forthcoming videos, when we try to create a mesh around aerofoil, I'll be explaining you the proximity and curvature option. So let us see what happens if I turn this feature off. If I turn the advanced size feature off, what is going to happen is the hexagonal quadrilateral elements that have been created here are going to become unstructured. Let me say generate. There you go. See what happens. They are still quadrilateral elements. They are still four-sided elements, but now it is very unstructured. This is a very good example of a very common misconception during meshing. Most of the people think that whenever you use structured elements, whenever you use quadrilateral elements, it is not necessary that the mesh will always be structured. This is the best example. We are still using quadrilateral elements, but the elements are unstructured. So how do you make it structured? We can make it structured by using an option called face meshing. So if you can right click on mesh, go to insert, there's an option called face meshing. This face meshing is like a iron box where you can just correct the. So now you can see that once I have used the face meshing option, the mesh has become extremely structured. So always bear in mind that it is not necessary that if there is a quadrilateral element, it is going to be structured. It can still be unstructured. And then if it is unstructured, you should use some method like face meshing to get it straight. Okay. So now let us explore some options here under the relevance center and relevance center smoothing and the span angle center options. So these are called global mesh settings where changing this will help you to make your mesh a little finer. So if you just note the number of elements now, so the number of elements now is 2025. Check what happens if I make the relevance center fine, smoothing high, and span angle center fine. Always try to use these settings because these are called global mesh settings. And when you make the relevance center fine, so relevance centers are actually centers between each of the elements here. So if they are made fine, they'll be very close to each other. And then the basic smoothing of the mesh remains high. And towards the end, the span angle center is going to be fine. So in this case, the orthogonality is maintained perfectly. And if it is fine, it means in the y direction. So you're reducing dy and dx and thereby making the elements much smaller. And see what happens when I hit generate mesh. Now my element count has gone to 2401. Earlier it was 2025. So this is one of the most commonly ways of refining the mesh. So if you can change the relevance center to fine, smoothing if you make it high, and if you make the span angle center fine, the mesh will become a little finer. So how to change the number of elements along the edges? We'll see that. So now we are going to go for the local mesh settings. Earlier we changed the options here, and this is called as global mesh settings, and this is not going to give you enough controls. What I am now going to do is I will right click, insert, and say sizing. So I am going to give the sizings for each of this edge, and I am going to say what is the element size there. Okay, so it is now asking me for which geometry. I am going to say this edge is going to be the geometry. I will say apply, and instead of number of in the definition type, default is element size. We will not be using the element size because this edge is now a one-dimensional edge, and you can just divide this edge into number of divisions. Element size will be used for face meshing and body meshing, which we'll be seeing a little later. But if you're going to give sizing for this edge, instead of element size, go to number of divisions. Okay, and in number of divisions, give it as 20, for example. So now if you can zoom in here, and I'll use the pan command so that you can actually see. There you go. So you can see that number of divisions here has become 20, right? And now if I say generate, see what happens to the mesh. Mesh will become a little disoriented. There you go. So there is 20 elements here now. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, and 20 elements. You can do the same for different edges. For example, I can click right click, insert sizing, and I can probably select this edge, say this edge here, and say apply. And instead of number of instead of the element size, I'll say number of divisions, and I'll try to make this 50. Okay, and then I'll right click, insert sizing, and select this edge, and I can say 100 in number of divisions. You can give a very differential treatment like this, and I'll leave here 20, whatever is the default. I'll say generate mesh. Let's see what happens. See now, the sizings have actually changed, isn't it? Now here there are 20, here there are about 100 elements, and then the sizing actually changes. If you want to, the problem is actually why the sizing is not changing is because the face meshing option is on. You can actually delete it, and if you generate the mesh now, you can visualize it a little better. Check what happens, see. So here I am having 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, about 20 elements. Here I am having about 100 elements. And here I am having about how many? 50 elements. And here I am leaving it as 20, this edge. So this is how you can give various sizings for different edges. So what we will be doing is, we will leave the opposite edges as about 20 and these opposite edges as 50, just to visualize as to what is happening. What I can do is to change it here. I will again select this edge, hold control and select this edge, and say apply. Oh, it's still in one edge. So I'll select this edge, select the other edge, and say apply. Now two edges have been selected, and here the sizing is going to be 20, and this is going to be 50, and I'll select these two edges now. Okay, so these two elements are going to be 50, and I'll delete the third sizing. Right click and say delete. And check what happens now. See, here I have 20, here I have 20, and here I have got 50. And again, if you can see that the elements are totally unstructured, and here I am having a triangular element which we should not be having. So now I should go to right click, insert, and say face meshing. And now I'll say apply and say generate. Now I'm converting the unstructured mesh into structured mesh. So the position where this face mesh is there is very important. So if it is before giving the sizing, then the sizing will not be affected. So you should give the sizing and always give the face meshing option later. So if you are going to do any change with the mesh, please delete the face meshing option, do the change, and then again come back to face meshing. So if you can see here, this is how you can change the number of elements in your mesh. So now the number of elements has come down to 1000. And now we can increase this to maybe, I'll say this is going to be 100, and then this is going to be 200, let's say. So the number of elements are going to be more this time. So I'm making the mesh finer. So you can go to mesh and see, you can see that the mesh has become very fine now. You can go to mesh statistics, now it is 200,000, earlier it was just 1000. So this is how you can increase the number of elements in your mesh, thereby making the mesh finer and coarser. On the other hand, what you can now do is, let us see the optimization options. I will reduce this to 50 and 20, okay. And now let us check some of the optimization options available. So I'm going to have some elements like this. You can see that the rectangles are actually stretched in this direction because number of elements here is less than the number of elements here. If we just change it, see what happens. 20, and if I say 50, the length of the triangle will be oriented in this direction. Quadrilateral, in other words. See what happens. See, this is how my mesh is going to be. So let us assume that I want to have a clustered elements around my edges, somewhere in these four edges. And I can have stretched elements in the middle, because let us say I'm not worried about the flow physics in the middle, and maybe I'm more worried only about the corners. In that case, what you can do is, in edge sizing, there is an option called bias type. Go to bias type, and now you can just see the representation of these dotted elements here. If you can go to the third option and see what is happening here, and just specify bias growth factor of 5. I'll tell you what it is later on. And now if you can see here, if you can zoom into this portion here, see, the elements towards the corner are going to be smaller and elements towards the center are going to be stretched. So this is what is the bias option. So you are clustering the elements towards the corner while you are stretching the elements in the middle. Okay. On these two edges, maybe we can do the same thing. We will go to bias. Bias type, we'll say third bias condition, and bias factor is 5. Okay, I'll tell you what the bias factor is, and I'll say generate. See what happens. Go to mesh. See this now. So the elements here are actually more, probably I changed the bias type here. Okay, I'm sorry, I should be using this option. Say generate. Yeah, you can see here that the elements in the corners are stretched, while the elements in the corner are clustered, while the elements in the center are going to be stretched. So this is what is the optimization option. What this 5% the bias factor I give 5, so it means that the growth rate of each element is going to be 5% as you move from the smallest edge. So maybe this edge, this size is going to be 5% bigger than the earlier one. This will be 5% bigger than this one. This will be 5% bigger than this one, and so on and so forth. Thereby, the middle point will be the middle element will be the longest. See what happens if I give a bias factor of 8. Maybe see the growth rate is increasing and it is becoming much smaller towards the corners. So I can say generate and see what happens. This is how the optimization algorithm actually works. So now we have seen how to give the edge sizing. Edge sizing is the most common way of refining the mesh along the edges. And now we have also seen the optimization methods, and we have taken a look at the face meshing option. So what I am now going to do is, the next option that we are going to see is the face sizing option. Now we are given a size for this edge, but instead of giving a size for this edge, I can give a size for this face, right? So I can just delete these two sizings, can select them, say delete, okay. And you can select this face by using the face selection filter here. Select this face, right click here and say insert sizing. Okay. And now if you can see, this is turned into face sizing. The sizing option is pretty dynamic. So whichever feature that you're selecting, if you're selecting an edge, it becomes edge sizing. If you select a face, it becomes face sizing. And if you select a body, it will become body sizing. And now here it is asking me for the element size. Now let me just change the units to millimeters. So if you can see here, the unit is in meters, kilogram, newton, second, so on here. So I'll just change it to units, millimeters. And I will say that the element size is 0.5 millimeters. Okay. So before that, what is the element size? Number of elements is 1000. Let us just see what happens if I say that the element size is going to be 0.5. And I say generate. It's going to take a little longer. And I'm making the mesh a lot finer now, and I expect the number of elements to have really increased. See, the mesh has become extremely fine, and the number of elements has increased from 1000 to 40,000. So it has become about 40 times finer than what it was earlier on. So you can either use the face sizing option and give the element size, or you can use edge sizing option and give the number of divisions to change the mesh refinement levels. So let me just delete the face sizing option here, and let me also delete the mesh option here, face meshing option here, and let me just say generate and bring back to original place where we started. Okay, so this is how my mesh is going to look like, and this is a unstructured quadrilateral mesh, right? So how to make it triangular? So just in case this is going to be unstructured, I can make it triangular as well. So we can do that by right clicking this place, saying insert method, select the face, say apply, and in the method here, instead of quadrilateral dominant, you can say triangles, say generate. Okay, so this is how you can cut. See, now it is a triangular mesh, isn't it? All the elements here are triangles. This is how you can convert a quadrilateral mesh into a triangular mesh. The option is under right click, insert, and say method. So with this, we have come to an end of the 2D meshing options. In the next video, we'll be taking a look at the mesh quality and 3D meshings. Thanks for watching.